God has a hard on.
Perfect world was a dream. Primitive.
Fucking asshole! He's a tight ass! He's a sadist!
You're all going to die down here.
The greatest trick the devil ever pulled was convincing the world he didn't exist.
Good tidings, my beloved truth seekers. Welcome again to the first real radio show dealing with the elusive and enigmatic topic of Gnosticism, coffee, cigarettes, and gnosis. An approachable, comprehensive, and affable discussion about the world's favorite and least known heretics, the Gnostics. Let's keep staying away from scholarly pontification and definitely away from New Age babble. The middle path it is in this frank discovery about Gnosticism.
You make the Lord very nervous.
And as one cat mentioned at the Free Thought Media chat room a while ago, why are the Gnostics the least known of heretics? Sure, the Da Vinci Code, the Gospel of Judas, the Mary Magdalene Revival, and the rising interest in Templars and secret organizations have brought Gnosticism to the forefront of Western civilization's psyche.
What's your point?
But they still remain the least known of heretics. Why is that? Because the sober reality is that about 80% of people who claim they are Gnostics are not true Gnostics. They're just New Agers who have found new fashionable clothing, radical dudes who have found libertine and immoral paths to self-indulgence, and, most of all, persons who believe Gnosticism is just direct experience with the divine.
You can't handle the truth!
How wrong they are. Experiencing the divine is but a slice of the pie, a fraction of Gnosis. If you haven't figured this through our various shows, then you're either sitting too close to your cat's litter box, or you just might not have the spiritual fortitude to experience true Gnosis.
This is your life, and it's ending 1 minute at a time.
Yes, Gnosis is communing with the transcendent, but it's also an inner realization of the world we live in, the people who surround us, and the false architecture that makes up our personas. It's an inner struggle as well as an outer struggle with the archons. It is a detachment of the world until you rise high enough to understand the dualities of existence and the rivers of thoughts that poison the ocean of the ego.
When someone asks you if you're a god, you say, yes!
And it is also the method to mend all of this. And it's still much, much more. This isn't a jog into feeling better about yourself and then bragging to friends at goth bars, but a marathon of lifetimes of commitment. But only a few can accomplish this, for it requires unpliable decisions and heavy crosses to bear. Believe me, I've wandered and met a lot of self-professed Gnostics who love the first mile of the alternative Christianity, but then take the first exit back to a compromise with the demiurge. In fact, that's how it is with most of these false Gnostics I've had the displeasure to meet. They come to me for answers, like I'm better than anyone else, and then slowly skulk away into the shadows of the angelic mafia to listen to themselves speak in internet forums. Most of the time, they don't even say anything but blow me off rather rudely. And you could make a case for the messenger being the problem, but I do have the scholars and the Gnostics to back me up on this show.
People do it every day. They talk to themselves, they see themselves as they'd like to be. They don't have the courage you have to just run with it.
But for those of you who continue with me on this dark odyssey through the gnashing rocks of orthodoxy, and understand the seas of fate are choppy, gather around, because today we discuss one of the greatest Gnostic sages of our modern times, Philip K. Dick.
I'm waiting to be impressed.
Outside of the Nag Hammadi Library and Elaine Pagels, who I continuously hound to come on the show, the great Dick has done more to bring Gnosticism to the forefront of modern society whether it be consciously or subconsciously. His themes of exploring alternative realities, the blurry vapor of human consciousness, and the liberation of the human spirit are ripe in his works. If you feel it carefully in his more popular expressions such as Blade Runner, Minority Report, Total Recall, Paycheck, Screamers, and A Scanner Darkly, you most certainly will recognize this.
If I'm not me, who the hell am I?
But his true Gnostic scriptures are found in his Valis trilogy after his 2374 experience, which we will talk about more later, when he realized that he was none other than the Apostle Thomas, incarnate, or more like projected through the hologram of this illusionary but pain-ridden universe.
God is a mean kid sitting on an anthill with a magnifying glass, and I'm the ant. He could fix my life in 5 minutes if he wanted to, but he'd rather burn off my feelers and watch me squirm!
Our guest today, Jeremy Puma, author of The Pirate's Garden, Running Towards the Bomb, and Brother Tom's Miracle Book of Signs and Wonders, as well as owner and administrator of the Palm Tree Garden, rewards us with a wholesale exploration of the great dick that few lay people know about. Believe me, Jeremy Puma knows his dick. And you can find the Palm Tree Garden, my home away from home, at thepalmtreegarden.org. You'll be able to locate his blog there, as well as other blogs and writings that are as elevated as the study of Gnosticism can be. And I'll be there in the chat room from now on, as well as the Freethought Media chat room, surrounded by true Gnostics who aren't afraid to make those hard spiritual commitments that sometimes have the whole of creation pissed off at you.
Send you here for life? That's exactly what they take.
As for me, I can't stress reading the Valis trilogy or some of his tractates, which you can easily find on the web. Hell, just go to philipkdick.com for some good data. Not only is the Valis trilogy worthy of the Nag Hammadi Library and a modern Nag Hammadi Library itself, the Great Dick uses technology, modern idioms, and approachable sci-fi concepts to make the idea of Gnosticism very easy to grasp. Not that his works will touch everyone. After all, you don't become a Gnostic. You discover you were one, like Dick did with Thomas. Know thyself and you will know the God in you and the false gods within you.
Better to reign in hell than serve in heaven, is that it?
I'm going to use just one example to show the Great Dick's immense insight into the esoteric and the heart of Gnosis. In the novel Valis, he speaks a lot about Wagner's opera Parsifal, written in the 19th century. Besides his many peerings into Wagner's obvious occult leanings, he quotes one scene in which a father tells his son before they go riding into a field, "You see, my son, here time turns into space." Now, how did Wagner, who died in 1883, figure out the theory of relativity generations before the great physicist came along?
Don't act like you're not impressed.
The Great Dick not only caught this, as he catches other insights previously unknown, but he proves that the esoteric, those in the occult, the shamans and the Gnostics, the magicians and the wise women, probably knew more about the cosmos than we give them credence. They knew the secrets of the universe as well as any egghead today, although they couldn't prove it empirically. But they knew. They knew just as the Buddhists claimed that the universe is made of mostly space, and the ancient Greeks knew of atoms. You see, my son, here time turns into space. And that's just a small crumb of the Valis trilogy that includes Valis, the Divine Invasion, and the Transmigration of Timothy Archer. All three very different books, but each one a trinity of almost pure, uncut thoroughfares to Gnosis.
Now open your mind to me.
To many people, like the movies based on him, it's just good pulp sci-fi. To those initiated into the mysteries of enthusiasm, Greek meaning when the divine enters us and becomes us, it is a living, breathing Nag Hammadi library. It is a benign virus of the spirit, as the Great Dick wrote about. We've touched upon the Great Dick and coffee, cigarettes, and Gnosis number 12, and also in coffee, cigarettes, and Gnosis number 15.
It was a disaster.
But this will get our hands and minds dirty, as they can, about the Great Dick. And Jeremy will also talk about the Palm Tree Garden and his new book, Brother Tom's Miracle Book, Signs of Wonders. So let allow time turn into space and onto the interview with Jeremy Puma. Okay, right off the bat, Jeremy, in your opinion, Philip K. Dick, Gnostic prophet, drug-induced madman, sci-fi writer extraordinaire, or all of the above?
I'm going to actually have to say Gnostic prophet. Well, yes, I guess that depends upon your point of view, but, he's certainly done more to introduce Gnosticism to modern society than probably all of the original Gnostic writers combined. I would guess to say that his influence on modern Gnosticism probably has reached more people than Valentinus, one of the original Gnostics, ever did during his lifetime, just because of how media is set up these days. Drug-induced madman, he was actually more of a speed freak than into any sort of major hallucinogens. But his madness is probably a very subjective matter. I mean, even he always recognized the fact that these visions and ideas and concepts he was having were very possibly the result of some sort of, mental breakdown, as opposed to direct contact with the divine. But it is something that we have to keep in mind when dealing with Philip K. Dick in a Gnostic perspective, is that chances are he was probably mentally ill in some way. It's just something that should always be in the back of our heads, that even he thought that the ideas that he had might not be direct transmission from the divine. A sci-fi writer extraordinaire, I would probably say no.
Really?
He was an amazing... His ideas and his thoughts and his concepts were phenomenal. And a few of his books are just beautifully written and amazing. But I would say the overwhelming majority of Philip K. Dick's work, his prose style was pretty wretched, actually. Mm-hmm. Some of his earlier works, especially when he was more into the pulp end of things, reading some of those, it's just, oh my goodness, it's laborious. But some of his work, his later works, and what he considered sort of his meta novel, which is a series of books with the Gnostic themes, such as Ubik, the Three Stigmata, Palmer Eldritch, and of course the Valis Trilogy, books along those lines he referred to as his meta-novel. Those are all fantastic. I mean, they're very well written, they're gripping, they're easy to read, they're really amazing. But a lot of his work is, it's basically literary tripe.
And when did he exactly learn about the Gnostic? Was it that vision that he calls the date, the three something something, or was it his contact with Valis, or did he actually study Gnosticism and said, whoa?
It's really difficult to sort of pin that down. Apparently, Philip K. Dick had a propensity for occasionally sort of elaborating a little bit more on reality than, what actually had occurred. And his interest in mystical Christianity, it's well documented. He was interested in that for a very long time. But, most people didn't know anything whatsoever about Gnosticism until the publication of the Nag Hammadi Library's translation in English in 1974.
Right.
Apparently, the story goes is that, he was... It's sort of, if you're familiar with Valis, character, Philip Dick in Valis, that's essentially, it's basically semi-autobiographical. And so, he was speaking with his doctor and describing his experiences, with his psychologist or psychiatrist, one of the two, I can't remember. And his psychiatrist was saying, this sounds exactly like Gnosticism, and gave him a copy of the text of On the Origin of the World from the Nag Hammadi Library.
Wow.
And then he read that, and that was in it, which would have had to have been, actually, according to the story, his psychiatrist had an in the scholastic community and was able to sort of acquire this translation a couple of years before it had been published. whether or not that's true is you know, kind of a, it's more of a myth than history, let's say.
But he truly believed in Valis. I mean, didn't he have an experience where Valis actually shot those famous rays? And who exactly is Valis?
He had a number of experiences that were more than just, you know, what we might these days call psychoses. Even though, again, you know, it's worth remembering that he, up until, you know, the very end, was always open to the idea that these might not be divine. This might not be. I mean, personally, I believe that he was experiencing the divine based on his, you know, own experiences. But up until the end, he was always willing to, you know, concede to the fact that it might be something just totally evil. But yes, he actually apparently, you'll see the date in his writings, in his philosophical writings. You'll see 2374, and that's February and March of 1974 was when he first had these major flashes, these major lights of inspiration. The myth goes, again, you know, myth versus history. The myth goes that he was convalescing from a terrible toothache of some kind, and he called the drugstore to deliver him some, you know, some pain medication. And there was a girl who came to the door to deliver it, and of course it was the archetypal Philip K. Dick had this thing for the dark-haired girl. So it was this archetypal dark-haired girl came to the door bearing this, you know, this packet with pain medication in it, and she was wearing a typical little Christian fish symbol. Mm-hmm. And he asked her, you know, what is that symbol? And she said, you know, she was explaining to him that it's the fish symbol. It was worn by the early Christians. And when she said that, it triggered something in him that essentially, according to the PKD myth, he experienced what he might call time starting up again, and remembered himself as a Christian named Thomas who was still living during the Roman Empire. And so that was sort of like the beginning of this series of experiences. He would have things like he would refer to this beam of light, he would call it a strawberry ice cream pink beam of light that would, you know, shoot into him and give him all of these messages, and he would hear voices and have these experiences. One of them that was more interesting from a, you know, from an objective standpoint is apparently it warned him that his son had some kind of very serious heart or brain problem or something like that. That, you know, you wouldn't have, there's no way that he would have known this. And, you know, basically God told him, like, rush your son to the emergency room right away. And he did, and it saved his son's life. It was true.
Wow.
That this actually happened. And so there are very interesting things that happened during his life that seem to indicate that it might very well have been more than just, you know, psychotic episodes that he was having. But again, myth versus history, it's hard to say.
So he truly believed that the apostolic times had started and time itself had stopped during the destruction of the Jerusalem temple in 70 AD, which that didn't make sense to me, because after all, knocking down the home of the mad god, the Demiurge, seems like a positive thing. Why did he choose 70 AD?
Well, I think it's something that needs to be very carefully thought about when we discuss Gnosticism's image of the false god, the Demiurge. The Gnostics were not necessarily ever under the impression that the god of Judaism was the actual evil god. I don't know if you're familiar with it. There's a letter. I'm trying to remember the name of the letter. From Ptolemy to Flora. Ptolemy was a Valentinian. And in it, he was describing to Flora that, you know, in the Old Testament, the depictions of God were divinely inspired, or they were created by men. There are these two different approaches to the Demiurge in the Old Testament. Or they were just simply to address the laws. So it's not as though the God of the Old Testament was, in every case, the Demiurge. And this certainly would have applied to the temple, inasmuch as this is where the Holy of Holies was. The Holy of Holies is a very important concept to the Gnostics in general. You find it mentioned in the Gospel of Philip repeatedly. The Holy of Holies and the bridal chamber are the same thing, according to the Gospel of Philip. I could look up the actual reference if you'd like, but I'm sure it's in there somewhere.
That's okay.
And so symbolically, mythologically, not necessarily historically, the empire destroying the temple was the control systems of Earth. In this case, the Roman Empire, as the control system, would be the representative of the demiurge, destroying the bridal chamber of Christ and Sophia. And the bridal chamber in Gnosticism is this sort of mythical space in which the soul and the Christos get together and get busy, which results in Gnosis and which results from Gnosis. I don't think it necessarily would be true to the spirit of Gnosticism to say that the temple in this case was the house of the demiurge. So that's how I might explain that to you.
Right, and you believe that the Gnostics were the ones who could actually see through the hologram of time.
As, exactly.
You know, we still lived in the Roman times or the Black Iron Prison. But who exactly is Valis?
Valis would be, he's actually referred, Valis is referred to even in some of Phil Dick's writings as the Logos.
He appears in different ones. He appears in the Divine Invasion and a few others. Mm-hmm. So.
Radio Free Albumus is uh-huh. big on, you know. Valis stands for Vast Active Living Intelligence System. It was always something seen as external in Phil Dick's books. To the point that in a few of them, it's even, you know, it's even in Valis itself, it's a satellite. It's an actual satellite orbiting the Earth that, ends up being, say, shot down by the Russians or, or appears in the film that the characters in Valis go to see as a piece of trash on the road, on the side of the road. They say, oh, look at that. I just realized that piece of trash in the movie was actually a satellite. It was this little satellite. And so it's this external thing that exists outside of the system that beams information about the true nature of the system into the Black Iron Prison, sort of. Valis is, it's the word of God. He also referred to it sometimes as zebra because it was something that would camouflage itself, I guess as zebras do with their black and white stripes. Mm-hmm. So it's just this sort of entity that breaks into the world of forms, the Black Iron Prison, in order to basically save the humans who are trapped in the prison.
And he also believed that the Nag Hammadi library was, I guess, the 1-2 punch, because didn't he write that it wasn't it didn't give off information, but it was also true information, almost like a benign virus, right?
Right. Well, he actually termed it the plasmates, what he called living information. What his basic, one of his, theories, and another thing that's important to keep this in mind, too, is that he, in the exegesis that he was working on for his entire, adult career, he would change his mind about these things very frequently. In one entry, Valis might be one thing, and a few days later, he'll say, I just realized Valis isn't that at all. It's this. And so, it's really sort of hard to pin down exactly what conclusions he came to, because he didn't come to any necessarily conclusions. What he did was he created these myths. I like to think of Philip Dick as like a one-man Nag Hammadi library. Because in the library, you have all of these different Gnostic sects and all of these occasionally contradictory myths. You have the Valentinian material, you have the Sethian material, you have all these different sort of, even have like a, an excerpt from Plato. Well, imagine if all of that was written by one person, and that's Philip Dick right there. Just at various times during his life and due to various experiences he had, he was constantly reassessing what he thought. It's sort of this idea of radical inquiry that we should never, ever, ever stop questioning. Always question, always question. It's a very Gnostic concept in general. But to get back to the question, what he thought about the Nag Hammadi library is that it housed living information in the form of what he called plasmates. And these plasmates were actually, in some cases, he would actually might consider them an alien virus of some kind. And upon their discovery, the discovery of the Nag Hammadi library, these plasmates were literally released back into the world.
and began to cross bond with humans, something that he called homoplasmates, once that cross bonding process had happened. I guess, you know, in some ways it's hard to say exactly how literal he was being, because in some regards I think that he actually literally meant that there was some kind of, you know, living intelligent virus that was going to cross bond with people as soon as they read this information. But sometimes, you know, I think he may have meant it a little more metaphorically, reading this information, because it's true that the information in the Nashtamadi library is, it's very much alive. That's something that, you know, you'll hear very often from people who read it, that it does often seem when you read this material that something has come out of it and into you and made you a new person. I think that's kind of where he was coming from a little, sometimes when that's what he was saying.
Right, and it makes
in regards to that, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does make sense, and it's perfectly Gnostic, because you can just, like you mentioned, read the Gospel of Philip, and you'll find contradictory terms. You know, in one place the Hebrews are good, another place the Hebrews are bad, or so forth. Mm-hmm. So that's switching your terms and everything is certainly a very Gnostic thing. He had also a very interesting cosmology. For some reason, and maybe I'm wrong, it reminds me of the Manichaeans, because he believed there was an upper, didn't he believe there was an upper yang or yin and a lower yang or yin, and the upper one, the real world, was trying to infiltrate the false world and the false creator and trying to heal it?
Well, I think his influences were pretty vast. I mean, we know for sure that he was very interested in the study of philosophy and religion for most of his life. One of his earliest novels, which is called The Cosmic Puppets, actually deals with Zoroastrian mythology. He actually names these two beings, Ahriman and Ahura Mazda, the two opposing forces of light and dark. And this is a book he wrote in the 50s, so as far, like, sooner, you know, he did that long before he got into Gnosticism. Since Manichaean is based so much on Zoroastrianism, that's one possible reason that it sounds so similar. But even more so, I would say his influences were Greek. Platonic and Parmenides was also another big influence on him. The idea that there is this ideal realm somewhere, a realm of ideals that's truth, that's goodness, that's, you know, essentially what the Gnostics might refer to as the Pleroma, that sort of divine fullness, and that somewhere along the way, something went wrong. He actually, in one of his works, the Tractates, which you can actually find in the back of Valis, and they're all over the place online too, he talks about the idea that in medical terms, what happened was that in order for this form one to know itself, it had no choice but to split itself into two parts, because, you know, you can't observe an infinity. There's nothing to stand outside of an infinity. So, you know, if an infinite being needs to observe itself, it can only do so by splitting into two. And that essentially drove God insane, by necessity. And so what we have here is we have this brain that's trying to learn about itself, but because it had to split itself into two parts to do it, the neurotransmitters aren't working properly. Mm-hmm. And what we are information processing receptacles. The DNA matrices and helixes within us are designed to interact with the world and transmit information about God back to himself. But because this process necessitated God going crazy, something's wrong with the way that we function. And what Gnosis is, the experience of Gnosis, is sort of kicking us back into whack, sort of allowing us to get that transmission process working again. Or another way to look at it might be we are beaming static back to the source that we're supposed to be beaming it to, instead of, like, valid information. And Gnosis tunes us into the information that we need to have to broadcast back to God. And this is another example of his sort of Gnostic insight, because it's almost identical to what's described in the Valentinian Gospel of Truth from the Nashtamadi Library, in which the same sort of idea that God had to, or the infinite or the limitless light had to break into pieces in order that it could learn about itself. It was the only possible way. And so this black iron prison and this ignorance that we are going through is actually necessary. It's not necessarily a bad thing because it's part of God's learning process.
Right. Kind of reminds me of how Krishna created the world just to get to know himself. Yeah.
It's very similar to that, too. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Parmenides said, you know, we have form one and form two, and form one is this place in which no motion exists because everything occurs all at the same time. And form two is the illusion of motion that we see, which, you know, Phil Dick also recognizes that this world is an illusory one. What we're seeing as motion is actually due to the fact that we can't perceive infinity all at once.
Because, there's that part in your in the forum where he's just talking to God, and God simply answers infinity.
Mm-hmm. That's actually one of my favorite pieces of his. That's from his exegesis, and that is sort of the manifesto of radical inquiry in some ways. In this particular parable, Philip Dick is basically having a conversation with God, and every time he comes up with some sort of theory about the nature of reality, it sets him off into this sort of infinite regression. In other words, these theories that he has only work if they go back to infinity. No matter what he does, you know, God basically, he challenges God. He says, you know, you must be this. And if that's so, then there must be an infinite regression. And actually, you know what? It might be worth just reading an excerpt if I could. Okay, so here we are. This was written, as a note, this was written in 1980. So, you know, a couple of years before he died. It was late in his career. So he says, God manifested himself to me as the infinite void. But it was not the abyss. It was the vault of heaven with blue sky and wisps of white clouds. He was not some foreign God, but the God of my fathers. He was loving and kind, and he had personality. He said, you suffer a little now in life. It is little compared with the great joys, the bliss that awaits you. Do you think I and my theodicy would allow you to suffer greatly in proportion to your reward? He made me aware, then, of the bliss that would come. It was infinite and sweet. He said, I am the infinite. I will show you. Where I am, infinity is. Where infinity is, there I am. Construct lines of reasoning by which to understand your experience in 1974. That was the one where he realized that time was illusory with the girl and the pain medication and all that.
Right.
I will enter the field against their shifting nature. You think they are logical, but they are not. They are infinitely creative. I thought a thought, and then an infinite regression, theses and counter-theses, came into being. God said, here I am, here is infinity. I thought another explanation. Again, an infinite series of thoughts split off in dialectical, antithetical interaction. God says, here is infinity, here I am. I thought, then, an infinite number of explanations in succession that explained 2, 3, 7, 4. Each single one of them yielded up an antithesis forever. Each time, God said, here is infinity, here, then, I am. I tried for an infinite number of times. Each time an infinite regress was set off, and each time God said, infinity, hence I am here. Then he said, every thought leads to infinity, does it not? Find one that doesn't. I tried forever. All led to an infinitude of regress, of the dialectic, of thesis, antithesis, and new synthesis. Each time God said, here is infinity, here I am. Try again. I tried forever. Always it ended with God saying, infinity in myself, I am here. And then he goes on and on and on, and he actually gets back into his conversation. He says to God, I said, probably it is you, since there is an infinity of infinities forming before me. There is the answer, the only one you will ever have, God said. You could be pretending to be God, I said, and actually be Satan. Another infinitude of thesis and antithesis and new synthesis. The infinite regress was set off. God said, infinity. I said, you could be testing out a logic system in a giant computer, and I am, again, an infinite regress. Infinity, God said. Will it always be infinite, I said, and infinity? Try further, God said. I doubt if you exist, said I, and the infinite regress instantly flew into motion once again. So basically, I think what we have here is Philip Dick saying that it's not the content of the arguments, it's not the theories that are put forth, but the very fact that every theory has an equal and opposite sets off this sort of infinite regress. There's infinite, you could sit there and argue it for infinity, and in the infinity of the structure, that's where God is. It's not in the theories.
That makes sense. And it seems God is trying to tire him out, saying, see how far you can go.
Right,
and if you give up, you're stuck.
Right.
You're stuck
in
the Ouroboros.
But even saying, God is trying him off, well, that sets off another entire, thesis, antithesis, synthesis for infinity. So, you can't nail him down. You can't nail God down. And I think Phil Dick really understood that.
It's kind of like all roads lead to God, or eventually everything, like the Gospel of Mary, everything will be brought to its root sooner or later.
Yep, exactly, exactly.
And moving on, and of course, I loved Valis immensely, and like I told you before we started, I think I learned more about Gnosticism, or it really opened my eyes to what Gnosticism truly is. But I had the same experience in The Divine Invasion. I'd been studying Kabbalah and it wouldn't make sense, and then I read The Divine Invasion, and I was like, aha, it makes perfect sense. How involved was he in the Kabbalah, and what made him write it?
I don't know how involved he was in that. He was a voracious student of all things mystical. So it's certainly absolutely a fact that he would have known about it. But to what extent, it's hard to say. I mean, I don't think he was involved in any sort of mystical organizations, but or anything like that. He mentions the Rosicrucians pretty frequently. But another thing too is that was sort of the part of the culture that he was in. California in the 60s and 70s when he was there. That's had a lot of exposure in the circles that he ran in. So it wouldn't be outlandish to find, Phil Dick and his friends sitting around stoned off their asses talking about Rosicrucians and the Kabbalah and, debating the characteristics of the Sephiroth. And, I don't know that there's specifically... I don't know that he would ever have studied it specifically to apply to that. It might just have been his nature to recognize the sort of Kabbalistic correspondences that were there. I don't know that I have a good answer to that question.
Mm-hmm. Well, you hit on something, because it's truly an amazing novel, and it kind of got me with the very Talmudic notion that God needs us as much as we need him, and then him bringing the whole concept of the advocate, which makes
totally
perfect sense. Could you explain a little bit about the advocate?
The advocate as far as the being who...
The really bad singer.
the being who... it's actually been quite some time since I've read this. You'll have to excuse me.
But
the advocate, by the advocate, you're talking about the being who speaks on our behalf to God.
Right, right. And it was it's like in ancient times in Egypt, there was no advocate. Everybody went to, I guess, the judge, Osiris or Thoth, and the advocate... somehow the shift in the whole spiritual world came, and this advocate came in and said, I can help you, and immediately free you from the bonds of the universe. And man in his ignorance usually turned the advocate down.
Right.
Which makes sense, because we always turn down our saviors. And he was unsure about the saviors. He seems he always changed it around. It's like, should I include Mani or should I not include Mani? Should I include this person or ask, everything else? So, pretty amazing stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, it's been quite some time since I've read those works in particular, so I can't remember necessarily the specifics. But yeah, he was always interested in the idea of a savior. His tractates even included the idea that, there was going to be, even in Valis, if you'll recall, there's this idea that the Savior was going to be born somewhere, and Horse Lover Fat, the other personality of Philip K. Dick and Valis, went off at the end of the book to look for this new Savior. I hope I'm not giving anything away to people who haven't read it yet, but I don't know. I sometimes think that Philip Dick actually thought that there was going to be someone. He never saw himself as the idea that people would see him in a religious light, to the extent that we do, would probably have cracked him up. I don't think he ever actually saw himself as, an important philosopher. I think he was trying to tell a good story, and I think he was trying to figure out the answers to the two Phil Dickian questions, what does it mean to be human, and what is real? Those are the two questions that always plagued him. But I think he was, honestly, I think sometimes he was more interested in telling a good story. The idea that these would actually be taken as serious religious concepts or religious studies by people would probably have, you know, just taken him aback and just made him bust his gut. I mean, so, but I sometimes think that he, you know, he might have thought that there was some sort of savior figure. He would very, like, the tractates include some very, you know, sort of prophetic, the head Apollo is about to return and Saint Sophia will be born again. And, you know, the Buddha is back in the park, in, you know, Deer Park. So, you know, there's this savior here that, the savior figure. And, you know, it's possible that he thought it was real. You know, in Gnosticism, we might, of course, prefer the sort of mythological interpretation that the savior is within each one of us. And so, you know, it's omnipresent and yes, the savior will come, but, you know, it's also already here and someone who has already come as well. So,
and in the third book, The Transmigration of Timothy Archer, almost mm-hmm. seems kind of out of place with this trilogy, because it seems it's just about one guy trying to find his own faith, this bishop, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. at the same time exonerate John Allegro. Did he really mm-hmm. Believe this? Was he into John Allegro, or
what was
the purpose of the novel?
Again, it was sort of part of the, I think it was sort of part of the zeitgeist that he was involved in. The idea that John Allegro, you know, being the individual who thought that basically the mushroom was the Eucharist, essentially, that the original Eucharist was a hallucinogenic mushroom. And I guess John Allegro did a number of studies in the Dead Sea Scrolls that, you know, seemed to maybe agree or disagree with that, I don't know, but it was basically the interesting religious topic at the time that this book was written. And, you know, this was a new idea. I mean, oh my goodness, the idea that these, you know, that these hallucinogens might have been used to induce mystical experiences, even in, my goodness, the ancient Jewish people and the ancient Christians. I mean, that was really radical at the time. And then you have Bishop James Pike, who was the basis for Timothy Archer in the book. And Pike was an interesting individual. He was a good friend of Phil Dick, and he was an Episcopalian. He was eventually sort of asked to leave the Episcopalian Church because he was pro-gay rights, for example, and he was very big into spiritualism. He believed that when his son died, he, through a medium, contacted his son, and so he eventually left the Episcopal Church. Or was sort of asked to leave. So the idea that he was into this, Bishop Pike very possibly was the kind of person who would have found these ideas intriguing. And indeed, he went to Egypt to research these possibilities, not necessarily specifically the ones put forth by Allegro. But while in Egypt, James Pike and his wife were driving through the desert in search of something. Nobody's really quite sure what they were doing out there. But they were extremely ill prepared and I guess their car broke down and he went off to go look for help. And, somebody found her, but they didn't find him until a couple days later. He was dead. Bishop Pike, he died. He fell into a dry riverbed or something like that. In the book, I don't believe they find Timothy Archer's body. I could be wrong about that. Again, it's been a while since I've read it.
Yeah, I don't think they do.
But you know, in reality, this is something that actually happened to Bishop Pike, and he was, you know, he was a very good friend with Phil. And after Bishop Pike's death, there was a period where Philip Dick thought that he might actually be possessed by Bishop Pike. He started drinking, for instance, he started drinking beer, and you know, he never had before, but Bishop Pike did, and he started thinking of all these theological thoughts that he wouldn't have known. He started having dreams in Greek, and he didn't know Greek, but Bishop Pike did. So that's just another interesting little aside there. But as far as the John Allegro stuff, it's hard to say. But I do think there's a lot of confusion surrounding the Valis trilogy, because it's such a strange trilogy. You have the book Valis, which is semi-autobiographical. It describes Philip Dick and his split personality alter ego. Horse lover, fat. And of course, horse lover, Philip translates into horse lover in Greek, and Dick means fat in German. So
right. You
have horse lover, fat, which is this other personality. And Philip Dick, the Philip Dick side, is this very sort of, you know, he's the side who would say, well, there's this there are logical, physical explanations for all of these weird things that are going on. It's not God talking to us. It's, you know, a psychosis or, you know, a conspiracy or something like that, but it's not God breaking in. And then the horse lover Fat is the one who is, you know, just completely into the idea that there's this phallus, that it's God breaking in, that et cetera, et cetera. And so in the first book, you have Philip Dick and horse lover Fat, of course, the same person, and their friends going through all of these experiences and eventually discovering, you know, the new Gnostic Messiah in the form of a little girl, and that's, and, you know, it sort of goes on from there. And then the Divine Invasion is very science fiction.
Yeah, pure science fiction.
Pure science fiction, you know. It starts off on another planet, and, you know, God lives on the planet and has to sneak into Earth, and, you know, it's very set very much in the future, and it's very pulpy, and it's very similar to some of his earliest science fiction in that, you know, it's sometimes comes across as almost space opera-y, you know. And then you have the third book in the trilogy, The Transmigration of Timothy Archer, which is not science fiction at all. Not in the least bit. In fact, it's almost mainstream. I mean, you know, if you put it in a different section in the bookstore, nobody would recognize it, you know?
Yeah, it's about interpersonal relationships more than anything.
Exactly, yeah. Now, the best theory, I wish this was my own theory, it's not. I can't take credit for it, but I don't know where it came from. The best theory I've heard as to why this is considered a trilogy and why this is so interesting is that, okay, you have Valis, and Valis establishes the foundation of thought in the trilogy with these two characters, Phil Dick and Horse Lover Fat. Then you have The Divine Invasion, and The Divine Invasion is a book that was written by Horse Lover Fat, the character from Valis. It's a little weirder, it's sci-fi, it's Horse Lover Fat. It's, you know, if a sci-fi author believed he was being communicated with by God, this is very possibly the book he would have written. On the other hand, The Transmigration of Timothy Archer was the book written by the Philip K. Dick character in Valis. It's a more materialistic look, a more rational look at the possibility of, you know, I mean, even down to the idea that the original Eucharist was mushrooms. I mean, that's definitely more of a reasonable explanation for experiencing the divine than the idea that God is trying to sneak in aboard a baby on a spaceship. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
So I think that's why those books seem so different. And then when you look at them in that regard, I mean, I don't know how long it's been since you read the trilogy, but after I read the trilogy the first time and then I heard that theory and went back and reread it, I was like, oh my goodness, it makes perfect sense. It's totally true. That's what it is. Valis sets the book, and then the two sequels are books written by the two split sides of Philip K. Dick.
Right, well, that makes sense. Moving on, what exactly led you to found the Palm Tree Garden? What can you tell us, Jeremy, its purposes and future goals?
You know, the Palm Tree Garden, which is, you know, it's a phrase from Philip K. Dick's tractates.
Right.
The Palm Tree Gardens was sort of the antithesis of the Black Iron Prison. And, you know, he believed that the discovery of the text of Nag Hammadi, when they released the plasmates back into the world, sort of heralded this new golden age of man, not necessarily in the historical sense, but in the mythological sense. And he called that, he said that was symbolized by the Palm Tree Garden. The reason that we started it, I definitely want to sort of underline that, you know, I got the website up and running, but it's definitely more than me. There are a lot of people. This Jordan Stratford has been involved in it, and Jesse, also known as Spark Widget on the site, he's been, you know, very heavily involved in it from the beginning. But basically, a number of years ago, I was running a sort of political web blog, and I was on occasion writing about Gnosticism. And at that time, I think I was like one of like three people in the greater community of web blogs who was writing about this subject. Me and Jordan and another gentleman named Tersh, who's with the Ecclesia Gnostica, I think we were it. But then all of a sudden we started noticing all of these, you know, over the course of the next year or thereabouts, all of these Gnostic websites started popping up. All of these different blogs, all of these different ideas, all these different concepts. We sort of termed it the Logosphere. There's Reverend Troy Pierce of the Ecclesia Gnostica in Salt Lake City It's sort of the blogosphere, you know, the logosphere, it's kind of a play on words. So we had this logosphere, and I was just thinking, you know, for all of their the amazing work they do, the modern Gnostic organizations are very geographically sparse. You know, there aren't very many of them. There are way more Gnostics than there are Gnostic churches.
Right.
And here we have the internet. It's this amazing new medium for, you know, getting people together. And so I thought, well, you know, it would be nice to have a hub where no matter the different flavor of Gnostic, you could come here if you have access to the internet, and all of the websites would be accessible, and there'd be a directory for of Gnostic organizations so you could find one near you, and there'd be a forum and a chat room, et cetera, et cetera. And so, you know, I ended up getting it together just because I was in a place where I could, and that's sort of how it came about. And, you know, the Philip K. Dick has always sort of been our patron saint for the very reason that he, you know, is that sort of one-man Nashamadi library, that, you know, his sort of the spirit of radical inquiry, sort of the major directive of the Palm Tree Garden. So that's sort of where it's at. Where we're going is it's in a large part going to be up to our members. We're going to try and seek nonprofit status probably sometime during this year. And I'd eventually like to see, you know, a couple of buildings of actual Gnostic centers of Gnostic study established by the Palm Tree Garden, but that's probably years in the future.
It's only been open for a year, so you still
right. It's just over a year, which is pretty amazing. I mean, that we've gotten even as many participants as we have. So, again, I can't underline the fact enough that like it's not anything that it depends upon one person. The people who hang out on the Palm Tree Garden are some of the most intelligent, erudite, and at the same time, you know, compassionate people that anyone will ever run across, at least on the internet.
Oh, I agree. Some of their stuff really blows me away. I'm in awe of some of the writings there, and I can't tell people enough to go there and learn, but be careful. You might be inundated by a lot of knowledge.
That's true, yeah. And, you know, as with any internet forum, things get heated every now and again, but we do what we can to try and keep that to a minimum. But it happens.
Yeah, well, if you get two Gnostics in a room, you know you're going to get two people who disagree on something. So that's just...
You disagree on many things.
Yeah, on many things.
Yeah,
who
absolutely.
Have different realities. But that's the way Gnosticism is, which is great about it. Like you said, it's organic. It's alive.
Mm-hmm.
It's not static. Not built on a rock.
Exactly.
And... well, moving on into your new book, Brothers Tom Miracle's Book of Wonders, the mm-hmm. question would be, why did you write it? I mean, a lot of people might say, oh, brother, there's another Gospel of Thomas book out. What
you know,
exactly, why does this stand one? Why does this stand out? Or what was your
it's
purpose
It's funny that
of
you
it?
Say that, because this is actually, this was just kind of a lark. I'm actually working currently, and probably will be ready for release a little later this month, on a book called... The Face of the Sky and the Earth, which is going to be an actual commentary on the Gospel of Thomas. On my original website, I was, for as many days or weeks as it took, I did a commentary on one of the sayings, the 114 sayings every day. And so I've been working on this, and just, you know, on a lark, because I happen to have this alternate sort of, it's not a translation, but I'd say interpretation that I'd put together. I just decided to whip it up real fast just as something fun to put out there on the Palm Tree Garden. Brother Tom's Miracle Book of Signs and Wonders. The idea came to me, and this is actually an idea that some individuals within the organized Gnostic church they have issues with. But the idea came to me that it would be interesting to see a folk interpretation of the Gospel of Thomas. The Gospel of Thomas, while it's one of the most accessible of the Gnostic works, at the same time, it's one of the most inscrutable.
Yes. Certainly.
You know, you have very, very strange sayings abound in this thing. And, you know, there are a lot of parallels. So it's easy for somebody who's never been exposed to Gnosticism to start with the Gospel of Thomas because there's a lot of familiar material there. But there's also a lot of really strange imagery in it. The lion eating the man versus the man eating the lion, for instance, or,
right.
You know, just these the real head scratchers. And I thought to myself, well, what if instead of having this gospel, having it sort of be this intellectual exercise that might have been studied by, you know, we picture Jesus standing on a mountaintop surrounded by his disciples, giving all of this information, and then the gospel being studied, you know, on the steps of the library in Alexandria, and, you know, Valentinus, you know, laboriously looking over it, et cetera, et cetera. I thought, what if instead these early Gnostics weren't so much like that? What if instead they were like a small West Virginia congregation of Pentecostalists? Like, what if these were basically everyday people who didn't have the vocabulary necessarily of, like, say, a Valentinus, who we know is incredibly well-educated? What would it look like? And so just for fun, I sat down and I went through all of the sayings and I thought, well, what if it's not like the Gospel of Thomas? What if it's Brother Tom's miracle book of signs and wonders? And it's something that, you know, there's a preacher standing on the back of a pickup truck and he's surrounded by, you know, just everyday field workers. How would he express these sayings to them? And so I went through and I did this. And so instead of saying, you know, the Gospel of Thomas, the saying number 42, be passersby. Well, if you're a student of ancient history, you'll know that that passersby was something commonly found on Greek tombstones. And it would be, the epitaph would read something like, oh, you who is passing by my grave, blah, 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 blah. And so it's possible that the original meaning of that saying was be someone who is passing by the corpse world, passing by that which is dead. And I thought, well, but, you know, you're not going to know that if you're just some, you know, somebody without this knowledge of ancient history. And so I rendered that instead of be passersby, the teacher said, just walk on by.
Yeah, because, it's a very approachable book, that's for sure.
Oh, thank you.
And I enjoyed it. Well, I think that's all the time we're going to have today, Jeremy.
Okay.
Thank you very much for appearing on Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis. Definitely gave us a whole bunch on Philip K. Dick to chew on. And I certainly hope to have you on soon.
Oh, yeah, I'd much enjoy that. It's been my pleasure.
There you have it, my beloved true seekers. Jeremy Puma on A Mite of the Great Revelations of the Great Dick, information on the solace and sapience of the palm tree garden, and his new book, Brother Tom's Miracle Book of Signs and Wonders. So next time you notice pink rays anywhere before you, maybe it's not some smart-ass kid with his laser pen, but Valis trying to break into your mind and reveal your spiritual apostolic succession. And the means to break away from the artifact, Dick's term for the demiurge. You think the Matrix might have been influenced by the Great Dick? After all, the underground streams of the esoteric are endless and conjoining. You just have to pick up the stone and split the wood, like the Gospel of Thomas says, to access the waters of anamnesis, a synonym for gnosis, and re-encounter your indwelling Christ. I read something Jeremy wrote on the palm tree garden. He said the first rule of Gnosticism is that we don't know anything. That dovetails with the Oracle of Adelphi telling Socrates he was the wisest man who ever existed because he admitted he knew nothing. That is one of the first stages of Gnosis, leaving all possibilities open and emptying your mind so that the radiation of the Pleroma or your Brahman enters the realms where your ego and Jehovah don't hold court. We are the Gnostics. We're writing our own gospels and living our own myths. And there is no better example in our modern times than Philip K. Dick. We'll be experiencing his influence from now until the universe collapses under the divine invasion of Valis and the new savior, Hagia Sophia. Or maybe we're all just crazy and delusional. Why not? Can't be worse than the screeching, bone-crunching that is reality we live day to day. An infection of suffering and cosmic injustice. Just as delusional and crazy when you think about it. I am, and I am Abraxas. I am you, you are me, I am a dream of you. Hello and goodbye as always.